as they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him.
Just pray, Jacob, as we're doing it. Just enter. Body of Christ as a church. We've learned one thing through this entire process. It's that the church is not a building. It's a place of people. A place where God's people can come together, whether you're on the street, whether you're in your front yard, in your backyard, we can be the body of Christ together in this time of separation. Let me read to you from Psalm 46. It says, God is our refuge and strength. He's an ever-present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her, and she will not fall. God will help her at the break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. Get this. He lifts his voice, and the earth melts. All it takes is the sound of his voice. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Then he gives us instruction. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Be still. Slow and steady. Allow your spirit to find a place of rest. In the midst of all of this chaos and all of this trial and all of these stirrings, Jesus is saying, I got this. Be still. Know that I'm God. So Father, today in the name of Jesus, we come to you this morning and we pray. God, we ask you to still our hearts before you so that, God, we can hear your voice. I pray, Father, we would just be steady before you and allow you to move. I ask, God, that you would speak. And as you speak, the mountains, the trials before us would melt like wax. In the name of Jesus. So I want to invite you just for a few moments. We're going to worship before we take a look at God's word this morning. If you'd like prayer at any time during this service, you can call our office at 623-4110, and we've got some people there on the phone lines that could take your prayer requests and just pray with you anytime within this time that we're recording. God bless you. Let's worship.
middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Sing a little louder.
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 Come on. Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies. In the presence of my enemies,
sing a little louder,
louder than the unbelief,
sing a little louder,
my weapon is a melody,
sing a little louder,
heaven comes to fight for me,
sing a little louder,
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. You're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Good to worship with you this morning, church.
the King of my heart, be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good. You are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. And let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. And let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. And let the King of my the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, yes, you are good, you're good.
Never gonna let me down. Woo! You're never gonna, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna, you're never gonna let me down. Oh, yes, you are never. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
'Cause you are good,
good,
you're good,
you're good.
And oh, yes, you are good.
So good. Yes, you are good, so good, oh. Yes, you are good, you're so good, oh, oh, you are good, you're good, and oh. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other found I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
Psalm 16, keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my Lord, and apart from you I have no good thing. As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrow of those will increase who run after other gods. I will not pour out their libations of blood or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Say that. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad. It's a position that I'm in. My heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. Get this. My body will also rest secure. Because of you, you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence and with eternal pleasures at your right hand. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. You know, a few months ago, if you would have told me that the events that are taking place right now in regards to the coronavirus, I wouldn't have believed you for a second. It's crazy how just in just a few weeks, our lives have fallen apart, right? The things that were familiar to us, the things that were comfortable to us, they no longer exist. I found that if I just say, you know, I'm just going to take 5 minutes in the morning and I'm just going to tune in and get a news update, see what's happening globally, that just those few minutes, just that little bit of time can leave me paralyzed with fear. You know, when a million different anxious thoughts are swirling around in our minds and the crisis that we're facing, the shock of it all just presses in on us, we have a choice to make. We can either allow the season that we're going through to bury us, to keep us from living, or we can learn to value or embrace this space in between what was and what is yet to come. This place unknowing, what was and what is yet to come. Grab a hold of it and allow God to, if you will, milk it for all it's worth. I'm a child of the 70s, and there was this group called Seals and Cross. They wrote this song called "We May Never Pass This Way Again." I hope we don't. I hope that we don't pass this way again. I hope that we never see this Pharaoh in our lives again. But what I do know is this, that if in this season we can allow God to use it, this space in between what was and what's not yet, if we can allow God to use this season, that the things that he will deposit into us, the things that he will teach us during this time, during this hour, if you will, you will never again have an opportunity to learn in your lifetime. Now, don't get me wrong, you're going to get a lot of lessons as you go along until he decides to take you home. But if you will allow him in this season of this pressing, if you will allow him to teach you and to deposit in you, then there are things that he'll put in you in this hour that never again in your life will you have an opportunity to learn. I really believe that. Thankfully, it's times like these difficult times, that God reminds us who and what matters most in life. I miss my boys. My boys are in Texas, both of them. My oldest son and his family are in Amarillo. My youngest son is in Lubbock at Tech. I miss my boys. I haven't seen them at all. I miss my wife. She's been self-quarantining after a recent trip to Israel. She'll be coming home today, but I miss my wife. I miss you guys. I miss the body of Christ. I miss just being able to relationally see your faces. you know, at least for this season, we've got some physical requirements, some distance that we're required to keep. I miss you guys. These things matter to us because we're hardwired for connection. Now, I consider myself an introvert. I do pretty good by myself. I can go places by myself. I can eat by myself. I don't need company all the time, I don't think, until I don't have it. And then I realize how much I really need relationships in my life, how much I need connection. I'm hardwired for connection. I want to take you to a passage of Scripture that the Lord deposited into my spirit this week. It was so rich for me that I'm praying that it will be the same for you. Turn with me, if you've got your Scriptures before you, to Matthew chapter 9. For those of you that don't have a Bible, I'm going to put it on the screen for you. But let's read just for a few moments in Matthew chapter 9. Now, right before we get to verse 14, Jesus is spending some time, verse 18, Jesus is spending some time speaking to his disciples. And the disciples of John are questioning Jesus and saying, we're fasting right now, God. Jesus, how come you and your disciples aren't fasting? And Jesus says, when the bridegroom is taken from you, speaking of himself, when I'm no longer physically with you, then you will fast. Rabbinic thought was fasting was associated with mourning. So Jesus was saying to them, listen, when I'm physically not near you, when I'm physically not with you, that's when you'll fast. Now, right in the middle of this conversation, right in the middle of this teaching that Jesus was sharing, there's a ruler that speaks up. And in verse 18, the Scripture says, while he was saying this, while Jesus was teaching his disciples, a ruler came and knelt before him and said, my daughter has just died. But come and put your hand on her and she will live. There was such faith in him. Just touch her, Jesus. If you just touch her, she's died. But if you'll just touch her, she'll live again. Jesus got up and went with him, and so did his disciples. So his disciples went on. They were following him. Now, that conversation was taking place, and when that conversation was taking place, then another story was taking place. A woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, she came up behind him, speaking of Jesus, and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, if I only touch his cloak, I will be healed. So the Scripture said that she was subject to bleeding. It was a meaning that she would have been ritually unclean. She should have been, let me put it this way, quarantined. And anyone else that she would come into contact with or touch or even touch their garments should equally have been quarantined. But she has this confidence in her that if she could just touch his cloak, Jesus' garments, that she could be healed. She wasn't about to identify herself to anyone that she came into or came into the crowd. She just thought, if I could just sneak up, if I could just touch his cloak. So, most commentaries believe that what she was speaking of there was his prayer shawl or his tallit. And these fringe are called tzitzit, and they're symbolic of obedience to the law. Now, you can have a tzitzit that aren't necessarily always attached to a prayer shawl. You can have a tzitzit that are attached to your pants. But she just thought to herself, if I could just touch his garment, if I could just touch his cloak, I will be healed. There's another account of this passage in Luke chapter 8. And the Scripture says, when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. As Jesus was on his way, the crowd almost crushed him. And a woman who was there, who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him and she touched the edge of his cloak. And immediately her bleeding stopped. This was a big deal. You don't see this in Matthew's account. The Scripture says, Jesus said, who touched me? When they all denied it, Peter said, Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you. Can you imagine the crowds? And Jesus said, someone touched me. I know that the power has gone out of me. So Jesus didn't see her, But he knew something had happened, because the minute she did it, the second, the instant she did it, the power went out of her. Her faith in Matthew chapter 9, she said, if I could just touch his cloak, I will be healed. Verse 47 says, then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, she came trembling at his feet in the presence of all the people. She was going to identify herself. She told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. We've been asked by the CDC to practice something that we're not altogether familiar with. The term is social distancing. That if we will distance ourselves at least 6 feet from people, it's likely that we won't get this virus. So I was praying this week, and I thought to myself, in the Old Testament, this wasn't an uncommon practice, social distancing. They practiced social distancing, not from people, but they practiced it from God. I want to take you to a passage in Exodus chapter 33. God had always wanted to draw close to men, but whenever he did, the people died. From Genesis to Deuteronomy, God wanted to be near his people. He tried to, but only to be faced with having to destroy them because their rebellion and their overwhelming sin. So Exodus 33 reads this way. Then the Lord said to Moses, leave this place, you and the people you brought up out of Egypt, and go up to the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I will send an angel before you and drive out the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Go up to the land flowing with milk and honey, but I will not go with you, because you are a stiff-necked people, and I might destroy you on the way. When the people heard these distressing words, they began to mourn, and no one put on any ornaments. For the Lord had said to Moses, tell the Israelites, you are a stiff-necked people. If I were to go with you, even for a moment, I might destroy you. Now take off your ornaments, and I will decide what to do with you. So the Israelites stripped off their ornaments at Mount Horeb. The old covenant required people to keep their distance. The old covenant required people to socially distance themselves from people. Excuse me, from God, because of his holiness. If they crossed the line, they would die. So this wasn't an uncommon practice to them. And in this passage here in Exodus, God is speaking to Moses, and God acknowledges that fact in verse 3. I won't go with you because you are a stiff-necked people, and I might destroy you on the way. Again in verse 5, for the Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites. So God was aware of the problem. He said, I can't be with you. You're a mess. There's too much rebellion, too much sin in your lives, right? That was harsh. Sounds tough. Sounds terrible. They had to distance themselves from God. They were dying in the wilderness in Numbers chapter 17. And they spoke to Moses. And the Israelites said to Moses, we will die. We're lost. We're all lost. Anyone who even comes near the tabernacle of the Lord will die. Are we all going to die? They said to Moses, what's going on, Moses? We're going to die. We're as good as dead. This is our death sentence, the message says. Anyone who even gets close to the dwelling of God is as good as dead. Are we all doomed? They knew it. They knew their situation. They knew if they even tried to get close to God, they would die. They had too much rebellion, too much sin going on inside of them. So here we find ourselves in Deuteronomy chapter 5. God has taken them from Egypt and through the Red Sea, and they find themselves at Mount Sinai. And God appears to them in this vision. It was fire on the mountain, the scripture says. And God speaks to his people. They were so overwhelmed. They were so overcome with the majesty of God that they said, Moses, we can't even go close to God. Will you go for us? Will you speak for us? Listen to this passage in Deuteronomy chapter 5. When you heard the voice out of the darkness while the mountain was ablaze with fire, all the leading men of your tribe and your elders came to me and you said, the Lord our God has shown us his glory and his majesty, and we have heard his voice from the fire. Today we have seen that man can live even if God speaks with him. But now why should we die? This great fire will consume us, and we will die if we hear the voice of the Lord our God any longer. For what mortal man has ever heard the voice of the living God speaking out of fire as we have and survived? Go near and listen to all that the Lord our God says. Then tell us whatever the Lord our God tells you. We will listen and obey. So they were saying, Moses, we can't do it. We can't even get close to him, but you can. Moses, will you go and tell us what he's saying? So this was a repetitive cycle. They couldn't get near to God because of their sin. So if they distanced themselves from God, their sin would just increase. It was a repetitive cycle. They would be further and further from God. They couldn't get near him. They couldn't do it. Listen, we're asked in this season to socially distance ourselves from people. I understand that. I respect that. I hope that you do too. But just because you're socially distancing yourself from people, don't distance yourself from God. In this hour of all hours, like I said just a few moments ago, if you'll allow him in this season that we're in to make deposits in your spirit, to speak to you, to point out areas in your life that need a touch from God, if you'll just sit before him, I believe you've got time on your hands, right? If you just sit before him just a little longer than normal, if you'll just listen a little closer than you're accustomed to, he'll speak to your spirit. The more we distance ourselves from God, the more we fall into sin and make a mess of our lives. But if we'll draw near to him in this season, he'll deposit in our lives in ways that we never even dreamt possible. The problem was, sin demanded a solution, right? And God knew that. Nothing could permanently take away the stain of sin. It was a hopeless situation that God was just going to have to fix. And the only way for him to fix it was to present a sacrifice, and that sacrifice was his son, Jesus. Nothing could take care of what needed to happen until Jesus came on the scene. Listen to this verse out of Ephesians chapter 2 and 13. In Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Jesus. Jesus, through his blood, one drop of blood made all the difference, allowed us to come near. That the instruction and the rules for distancing ourselves from God were completely gone because of the blood of Jesus. I was so impressed yesterday morning in prayer, things don't always happen by surprise. God is completely aware of everything that's going on the earth today. It hasn't caught him off guard one bit. A little moment on Friday night, and I heard some reports and it got me shook up, and I thought, man, boy, this is a big deal. And it is. But it started to shake me up to the point that I felt myself just questioning God. And I heard in my spirit, not an audible voice, but I heard in my spirit, the Holy Spirit speak to me. And he started to rehearse and bring to my remembrance different circumstances and different situations when he's come through when I least expected. And he would say it this way. This is how I heard it in my spirit. Didn't I do this for you? didn't I tell you that I would do this for you? He reminded me just a few days before how he revealed himself in his character. Just surprised me with his goodness and his kindness. And he said that over and over. He just kept bringing it to my remembrance, things that he had done for me, ways that he had spoken to me in the place of prayer as I got near to him. And then I heard the Holy Spirit say this. It was a bit of a rebuke, but it's in his kindness that he leads us to repentance, right? And he said to me, will you just calm down? Jerry, will you just calm down? At first, it kind of took my breath away, and I went, yes, sir. Yes, sir, I will. I'll calm down. Because I knew God. I knew God was speaking to me in his kindness. I'll never forget that lesson because of what it did for me in my spirit. The minute he said, calm down, and the minute the Holy Spirit allowed me to say, yes, sir, man, it was just this blanket of peace came on me. It was in the evening, and I was able just to go right to sleep. God wants to speak to us this way. And because of Jesus Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ, he's made it possible for me to come near and you to come near. It's unfortunate that it takes sometimes seasons of turbulence and chaos to bring us to a place that we cry out to God. But get beyond that and just cry out to him. He wants to hear you. He wants to see you. He wants to be with you. He wants to know you. Isn't that good of him? I learned an interesting word this week. I was praying earlier this week, and I was praying about being in the presence of God, in the sanctuary of his presence. So I looked at the word sanctuary, and you know what Webster's Dictionary describes sanctuary as? Immunity. Sanctuary is an immunity. To be in the sanctuary of his presence allows you to be immune from all of the chaos. And I'm praying from all of the sickness and all of the disease, that to be in his presence, he guards us and he surrounds us and he protects us. Isn't that wonderful and awesome? God, don't let me leave the sanctuary of your presence. I want to hold on to your presence. I want to be near your presence. We're going to take communion here in just a few moments. I encourage you, if you'd like to take it with us, to slip into your kitchen and grab some crackers and some juice possibly. And we're going to break bread and we're going to drink from this cup. I find myself incredibly grateful for the body of Jesus Christ. And that's what this represents, the broken body of Jesus. That he took sin upon him and he bled so that I could be free. He gives us a cup representing the blood. Excuse me, he gives us a blood that's representative in this cup. And we take this cup and we drink of this cup and we break this bread and do this in remembrance of him. He says, do this and remember me. So this is what I want you to remember. You don't have to be away from the Lord. I don't care what you've done that makes you feel like you're not allowed into his presence. Because of Jesus Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ, you can come near. Doesn't matter what you've done. Come home. Come home to him. Maybe you've been resisting for a long time. It's all right. Now it's time to come home. Don't stay away one moment longer. We're going to hear from Ben as we break bread this morning. We invite you to do this with us.
bow before the Lord and sing praises to your throne. You alone are worthy. The God who always was, the God who is and is to come, you alone are worthy. You alone are worthy. And hallelujah, our King has come and all creation sings heaven's song and holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. See?
Let's just take a few minutes to just come to the Lord in prayer for people around the world and people in our body. Let's start, if you would, just join me in prayer for just people in our body and people we know. We're going to have the prayer requests up on screen here. Father, we just, again, we thank you for just your ear, that you're always, you hear us. No matter what, and in this situation especially, we thank you for time that we've been able to spend extra time in prayer with you and the way you've been speaking to us. So, Lord, we just lift up these requests. We lift up Matt Harbor, Stan and Patty's son, Lord, for the issues that he has requiring surgery right now in his spine. Lord, we pray for Mardine Cooper as she was airlifted to El Paso. Lord, we just pray for healing for her. Lord, we pray for Joy Bostick, Jenna Blewett's mom, Lord, as she is now receiving hospice care. Lord, we pray for Dennis Smith, also now receiving hospice care, as well as Stan Harbor. Lord, we just lift him up to you. He's been told that it's time for hospice care for him as well, Lord. We just pray for healing. We pray for comfort. We pray for your presence for all of them, Lord. We pray for Jenna Vaughn. She's been diagnosed with cancer. Lord, we pray for healing as well for her. And Josh Link right now, as he's in Seattle, as he has gotten some negative news from his recent CT scan, Lord, we just pray for protection for him and his family as they're in Seattle and he's getting treatments, Lord. Pray for just for Annie Chavez, Charlie Thompson, Frank Gatlin, Rick Roberts, Chris Lewis, Tommy Martinez, Sean Lee, Heather Field, Richard Harris, Diana, Kathleen, Lord, again, just so many in our body and friends and family that need your healing, Lord. And we also pray for Abe and his family, Lord, as his dad passed away yesterday. Lord, we pray for just your healing presence and your comfort with them, Lord. And just even now, so many around the world and in our even here in Chavez County that are sick, Lord, we just pray for healing for them. Lord, we pray for just the many people who've lost their jobs. Pray for those who run businesses, Lord, that are just having to make hard decisions through this while they're closed. Lord, we know, Lord, that you are faithful. Lord, we thank you that you hear us. We thank you that you provide for us. Lord, we pray for our governing authorities, Lord, that you would just give them wisdom in these situations, wisdom just to make wise choices in these times. And Lord, we just pray there's so many around the world. That's why we have this map here. We have so many around the world that are still doing vital ministry here in Roswell. Lord, we pray for the homeless shelter. You protect them, every one of them, the volunteers and people that are staying there, Lord. May your presence be there, Lord. We pray for the ladies at Reflections and Recovery, Lord, that you just continue to strengthen them in all that they're doing there, Lord. We pray for Community Kitchen. We thank you that they're still serving meals to people daily. Thank you for their being willing to just provide that vital ministry through this time. Lord, we pray for Harvest Ministries as well, as they provide groceries for so many families even through this, Lord. We pray for all those that are ministering here in Roswell right now. And also, Lord, we lift up those around the world, missionaries that you just help them to be a light, your light, your love, that you'd protect them, strengthen them, open doors, Lord, for your love and forgiveness. We pray for Marita in Amsterdam with YWAM, that you just heal her, strengthen her body. Lord, we pray for the people of Mexico as prices are rising for food items they need and many people can't work. Lord, we pray for Agua Viva, our sister church there, Lord, that you would just be a source, that they could be a source of your love and your provision for the people of Juarez. And we pray for Outside the Bowl as they provide meals for so many, Lordy, but even as they shut down schools, Lord, we pray for provision and just a way for them to still be able to get the meals to those children. And Lord, we just thank you for the promise you give us in your word. And we just right now pray Psalm 33, the end of it. We wait and hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're all just really thankful for all of you that are online right now, joining us in our online community, still the body of Christ. Just so you know, throughout this week, we're going to still be here in the office. Please, if you need anything, prayer, or if you need something delivered to your house, we're here. Please call us. You know our number. If you'd like to give, I believe that's up on the screen right now. You can still give by text or give online as we continue to just try to support the community as well. And also, updates, we don't exactly know what this is going to look like in coming weeks. We're following the news as well. But just watch our Facebook and watch our website for updates on what our plans are for service as well as Ascension and 315 Kids.
We're so glad that you were able to join us this morning. Before we get away, today we were going to celebrate Liz Huddle's retirement and the 25 years that she's given to this church as an office manager. We're going to miss her terribly. We're going to postpone a party, a celebration for another date, but just this morning, we just want to tell you, Liz, how much we love you and how grateful we are for the investment that you've made into all of our lives and into the life of this church. So we bless you. We're going to have a party with you real soon. If you'd like to send her a card or a gift, a note, call our church office. We'll show you how you can get in contact with her. Usually at the close of the service, I read from Numbers chapter 6. We're going to do that a little bit different this morning, and Cheryl and I are going to worship with you in closing from Numbers chapter 6, the blessing.
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. children, may his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you. Children and their children, may his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. For you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. Amen, 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 amen.
Pray today that your Holy Spirit would watch over us, and that God, as we experience your nearness in times like these, that God, the deposit you leave inside of us would never leave us, and that Jesus will hold on to it even for years to come, and it will be a reminder to us how you've taken care of us, that even though mountains may crash into the sea, you are with us. And so, Lord, I bless the people of God today. I ask that you pour out your peace. Father, be with us this week until we see each other again. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you. May he lift up his countenance toward you and be gracious and give you peace. God bless you.